You are watching a close-up look at animal welfare issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by AnimalWelfareIssues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's AnimalWelfareIssues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Hi, I'm Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein, and thank you for tuning in. Well, it happened again at the Animal Rescue League of Berks County. In my previous show, I had my guest, Tiffany Wegman, on there because her pet cat, Violet, was mistakenly euthanized by the ARL within 4 hours of her arrival, and that happened last month. It's about a month and a few days later, this happened again. On November the 12th, Sir Diddy went missing, a pet cat of Cody Lesher and Samantha Curran. And the neighbor found Sir Diddy, and I guess this person thought they were doing the right thing. They took the cat to the ARL at 3:30 p.m. ARL closes at 4. So there's no time for the owners to go there. And so that was Sunday. On Monday, the ARL is closed. And then on Tuesday, they were there before the doors were open, similar to Tiffany Wegman's case. Her husband was there before they were open. And so they go in there. They were told that their cat was not registered there, and there's no cat that fits their description. So they went home, spoke with the neighbor, and the neighbor actually had footage of the cat and, in fact, was Sir Diddy. So they went back. And in the end, they were taken to a small room, and they said that, in fact, Sir Diddy was euthanized. They said he was scanned, I believe, twice, and no registration came up. No information was there. They scanned his deceased body, and they found the information. What had happened is that the microchip migrated up north to the neck, and that's where they found this information. So now, within a month's time, we have two grieving families over the loss of their pet cat. How did this happen? And there is such an outrage now with the public and a lot of mistrust with a lot of the public. People are asking them to shut down, stop donations. Some people have threatened them with firebombing some of the homes of the staff, which you don't do that, people. But I want to revisit here with my guests. I have Tiffany Wegman here I'm going to ask her in a second how she felt when she heard about this. And then I also have Dee Simmers, and she runs a few pages on Facebook to help the lost cats and dogs in Pennsylvania. So I want to start with Tiffany. Tiffany, when you heard this, I mean, your family's still in the process of grieving for Violet. How did it make you feel seeing something happen so fast when they said they were changing their policies, and here we are with another pet cat?
Shocked. It was only 5 weeks since it happened with Violet, so we were shocked. At first, when I read it, I thought it kind of was a joke. Like,
you didn't believe it?
No, not at all. It was 5 weeks.
Yeah, I mean, can't be.
No, it can't happen again. I mean, maybe in another year, maybe in 2 years, but not 5 weeks, something so similar happen again.
It's not even quite 5 weeks, believe it or not. It's just a little over 4 weeks. It's 4 weeks and like 2 or 3 days.
Yeah,
you're right. But not that makes any difference. It's just the fact that something so big, when Violet was euthanized, and the outrage from the public, and the ARL has been under scrutiny ever since. And Tom Hubrick, the interim executive director, said, you know, he came right out and he addressed this and said, you know, they're going to change some policies so as to, I don't think you can guarantee this would never happen again, but certainly not happen in such a short amount of time. When I saw it, I was getting flooded with messages, and it's like, you've got to be kidding me. It's like, no. And it's like, I was stunned. Dave, what did you think? I mean, you know, you're an advocate for cats mm-hmm. and dogs. What did you think?
I was very upset to hear that, to hear this again so soon. You would think that they would have immediately placed mandatory changes so that it wouldn't occur again. And like you said, here we are once again.
In both cases now, they said Violet was aggressive.
Yes.
Okay. And they also said Sir Diddy was aggressive too. And I have to question them, what do they deem as aggressive? I mean, don't you think cats that come to a shelter, any animal, right. is going to be stressed out?
Absolutely. And there, I feel where maybe there should be a little more proper experience training, especially with cat handlers. A cat's a little different, you know, than a dog going in. Of course, cats and dogs are going to be petrified. But if they're experienced staff members, they should know a cat is going to need a little more adjustment period. And for them to say a cat gets aggressive, I don't know. I can't see being that afraid of a cat. You know, and the need to go to the degree that it went to.
Well, I personally had been bitten by a cat, and it is horrific. Mm-hmm. And it was a relative's cat. And I've been bitten by a dog as well, right near my left eye. And I will say the cat bite was far worse, but there was the body language. And it was just one moment too late before I removed the cat. And I don't blame a cat. I was never angry with the mm-hmm. cat. However, I worked at this shelter, and I've seen aggressiveness, and I've seen it with the feral cats. Mm-hmm. The feral cats with their aggressiveness and a cat who is afraid, there is a vast difference. Mm-hmm. Feral
Absolutely.
Cats will be very, very aggressive. They can be mean. It's like they're not socialized with people. They're
right.
not socialized to be indoors. So to be in a cage, a small cage, when they're used to freedom and to be handled by somebody, yes, that's when I see true aggressive behavior. So I have to ask, what do they deem aggressive? And I completely agree. They need changes there. And I believe the staff absolutely need somebody qualified to teach them mm-hmm. how to understand animal behavior when they come into a shelter.
Absolutely.
Because it's not indicative. When I work there, and when I've been with other rescues as well, they always say with the dogs, don't take this to be their true personality. When they're inside that cage, they can go cage crazy. That means they pace around in there, or they're barking, or they can just act crazy, if you will. And once you get them out, they're as calm as can be. Mm-hmm. So that, I feel they need somebody that has the training to train them. And has the Animal Rescue League offered to do that? Because Tom now has put out two posts on Facebook explaining this, but I didn't find that there. Have either of you?
No. I mean a solution? Or
as far as solutions?
No.
Coming from the Animal Rescue League?
No, the only solution that I heard when we were dealing with our cat Violet was that him and someone else were going to be the ones that had to sign off on any other euthanization from that point on. And then they were going to regroup and, you know, try to look at it. But besides that, no, I've heard nothing.
Well, I heard that he was in this decision-making process for Sir Diddy. I don't know how many others were involved. I don't know if a veterinarian was involved in deciding if this cat should be euthanized or not. I want to say Cody Lesher and Samantha Coran wanted to be here. They are Sir Diddy's parents / owners. There's a scheduling conflict. I also want to say Tom Hubrick, the interim executive director, he said he agreed to be here as well, but there was also, again, at the last moment, there was a scheduling conflict. But Tom said he would come on a future show to answer the questions, the tough questions. So I guess there are so many questions from the public trying to understand how this could possibly have happened so soon. Now, getting back to when they make this decision, and Tom is one of the decision makers, with all due respect, Mr. Hubrick, I have a problem with that, and maybe you can enlighten me, either one of you. Mm-hmm. Does Mr. Hubrick have a background working with animals?
Everything, his most recent post yesterday morning, I did not see anything that he had any kind of experience with animals. I'm kind of a little shocked that he's in this position.
I know from what he had written, he said he was put in this position to help understand what the problems are in the shelter. And he is there to find out what they are so they can create solutions, and that his firm, not the ARL, but his firm, is picking the new director. And his position is lasting 6 months, so he's there a little over 5 weeks now. And from everything I have found out, everything that has been brought to my attention, he has a business background. He's worked with nonprofits, but I don't see him having experience with animals. And this is not tearing apart Mr. Hubrick, not by any means. You need business sense to run an animal shelter, no doubt about it. But you also need the sign that has experience working with animals. And I feel someone who has the experience working with animals should be included, a veterinarian, the staff who are greatly involved. And I just don't know if he is one of the right people in making a decision to take the life of an animal. Your take?
I totally agree. With this happening so recent from Violet, you would think they would have put another protocol in, as far as just not just one person making a decision, that it should be several people. And I'm curious, he did say that several people were involved. I guess it was discussed. I'm not 100% sure exactly what was said, but it was like several people made this decision. Well, I would think, didn't Mr. Hubrick, wouldn't he be one that would have to sign off of that? Who signed off on that?
He did say that after Violet's death, he said he would be one of the people partaking in that decision. And from what I heard, he and other people were involved in making this decision. But when I worked there, it was the staff who really knew the animals that were involved in deciding who gets euthanized. Let me tell you, don't take that lightly. I mean, the staff, when I worked there, I can only speak of when I worked there, this was no easy task. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you, some of the people told me, I can't tell you how many people were on antidepressants. Some drank, some said they started drinking, once they were responsible for making a decision like that. One even said, they're going to go to hell. It was part of the job. And to make that decision is very, very, very difficult. And to be the one to administer the medicine, I've been there too many times. It was not part of my job, but I wanted to be there. I want the animals to be loved. So I am saying this in a constructive way, Mr. Hubrick, that this is for the animals, that I feel that someone with, and you're hiring for a new director, someone with experience with animals, if they're going to partake in this decision making, that has to be a requirement with the new director. They absolutely need the business sense, and I can see how you do want to run things in a better way for the Animal Rescue League. So I'm not trying to tear down the Animal Rescue League. In fact, Tiffany even said, people are calling for this place to shut down. I'm totally against that. You can't shut this place down. The community needs the Animal Rescue League. Without it, where will the animals go? if you think they're going to the Humane Society, I think you need to rethink that, because that's the only other major shelter to handle thousands and thousands of animals. Rescues are filled, but we need to come up with more solutions, and it starts with the Animal Rescue League, and I think you need to be transparent. What do you think? What else do you think that they need to do? Because we need to talk about solutions. We want this place to succeed.
Right.
We don't want to see this happen again. And neither Tiffany nor Cody or Samantha has spoken about having this place shut down. They've not spoken like that. In fact, Cody, I've been in contact with Cody, and he wants to see this place run better so this never happens again. And Tiffany said the same thing. So what else? What else? Well, first of all, you're involved with Justice for Puss, another cat that was euthanized at the ARL in 2015. Mm-hmm. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
Puss's owner was taking him to the vet, and there's a picture. And he got out of his carrier and got loose. He was missing for 8 months. Somebody did find him and took care of him for a while, did notice that his ears were like flopped down, so that's a sign of ear mites. She thought that she was doing the right thing by taking this cat to the Animal Rescue League. Within hours, he was also euthanized, and their excuse being was because he was sick. And this owner did everything right. She had flyers out. They posted flyers everywhere. And, you know, for ARL not to take the time to see if this was a missing cat and to euthanize it within hours of it being there and using the reason that it was ill, it's just, it's hard to sit here and not want to cry. My heart goes out, still goes out to them and to other cats, to Tiffany and to Cody. Mr. Hubert is asking for suggestions to make changes for the public to help. I have several suggestions. I think we can all agree that you have the power to make it mandatory to put a hold on the cats. My goal, and I believe Tiffany's goal and several others, is to get a law passed with Pennsylvania that there is a mandatory hold for cats. And when you find a cat, don't always assume that it is a stray. Take the time to find out if there is an owner. I have a program, Mr. Hubert. You can contact me anytime. Email me. It's Helping Lost Pets. I run Lost Cats Pennsylvania and Lost Dogs Pennsylvania. It is an amazing program. Owners can have a flyer. If it's missing or if somebody finds a cat or a dog, we have found flyers. This program goes right on to your computer. It's a click away for your staff. When somebody surrenders a cat or a dog, a click away, they can see if this dog is listed or cat is listed. But I still feel definitely there needs to be a mandatory hold, because not everybody has social media. Not everybody knows what to do. Some people go to the newspaper. So we need to help. Basically, we all need to come together as a team, so that people know, okay, this is what we do. And there are so many amazing groups on Facebook for missing or lost or rescues that are willing to help. We are willing to foster.
And they need to reach out.
Yes.
To these groups. I'm hoping they reach out to others. I know that they said their policy was on for 24 hours. However, when you're closed, you know, Sunday, Sir Diddy was taken in, and Monday they're closed, and the 24 hours is up, and you know, this person cannot get a hold of anyone,
right?
You know, at this shelter during those 24 hours. That's not a fair 24 hours.
No.
So, I do believe I read that they're going to extend that, and you were talking about a law. Well, ever since Violet was euthanized, I have been doing that. I have started working on a bill for the state of Pennsylvania for a holding period of time, and it will be named Violet's Law. Because I didn't want to see this. When this really touched me with Violet, never would I imagine that we'd be sitting here, you know, in just a little over a month's time, and talking about another cat. So this calls for serious, serious solutions.
Right.
And anybody out there, if you want to help, I have some national organizations helping guiding me. But if you're more than willing to help me, I will gladly take that help. But because it's going to be a long process, this is not going to happen overnight. No. That's a guarantee here in Pennsylvania. We know that legislation goes so slow. So we need that. But meanwhile, I believe Mr. Hubrick said they are going to extend that time. Now, I also have a question with this microchip. They scanned it. Now, when I worked there, I watched the people scanning, and they would take across the whole body because they said, you know, these chips migrate. And so this is what I would see, like all around the body. And this is right up in the neck. They need training to properly scan. Sir Diddy should not be gone. Sir Diddy had a microchip. So I don't understand. I mean, they found when the cat was deceased. So they need more training with that as well. I mean, you're told, oh, and I didn't even say this, they adopted Sir Diddy right there. Sir Diddy from the Animal Rescue League this past January. And Cody wanted me to tell you, and I apologize, I don't have his information directly in front of me, but Sir Diddy, he said, was one of the nicest, sweetest cats, he said, you could ever, ever meet. He'd snuggle with you, come up and you crawl under the covers. He got along with everybody. He said he was just a joy. He said he was the joy of his life. And he and Samantha are very, very devastated over this loss. And even though it didn't work out for them to be here, he was shying away. He said he did not want the TV publicity. However, he did want to come on here and get his story out. But it just didn't work out anyway. But Cody also wanted to say that the staff at the ARL are saying that Sir Diddy was violent, and he is really taking them to task on that one. He said Sir Diddy never showed any signs ever of being aggressive, let alone being violent. Said he never hissed, he never clawed at anyone. So he says he's very upset with that, and that information is put out there, and people are believing it to be true. Will a cat act differently? Yes, and I think any animal, I'm sorry, any person who works in a shelter understands that a cat, a dog, will act differently in a shelter setting. Okay. So I want to get out there, you know, from Cody. I mean, we're so sorry, you know, for the loss of your beloved cat. And I know your whole family loves Sir Diddy, and this is a huge loss. And I know what Cody wants is what we were just talking about. He does not want to see this happen again. He does want to see a law being passed. So there are holding period times so people will have a chance to get to a shelter to see if their cat is there. And utilizing, they found out through social media, I think through one of the groups on Facebook, but I noticed on their website, on the ARL's website, they have over 200 cats, they say, but they only have like 35 cats posted. That's such a tiny number of cats. I just want to take 2 minutes with my final thoughts, but do either of you have some final thoughts here? How we move forward from this?
Move forward, I think immediately it needs to go into effect. If Mr. Hubick really, really wants to help us, he needs to set in place right now mandatory hold on cats until we can work together as a team and come together with a proper solution so
for
this does not happen again.
How long do you think the mandatory hold should be?
I would say as long, whatever the mandatory hold is for a dog. Why should it be any different for a cat?
There's no law. It's different for a licensed dog versus an unlicensed dog, but it is typically 48 hours. And if they're full, they will just do the 48 hours for a dog. A licensed dog, they get 5 days.
Yeah.
Now, when I worked there, they did actually give them 5 days for dogs. But I knew when cats came in, literally, if somebody surrendered a cat, they could, you know, as soon as they're leaving, they could literally just euthanize that cat. It is legal. They did nothing illegal here. However, this is just not the way to handle it. Any closing thoughts?
No. It takes 10 seconds to grab a phone out of your back pocket, snap a picture of a cat. Everyone has their phone. Just go to Facebook. I got this cat in. I mean, just go the extra step.
You're saying to post it?
Yeah, post it. Just post it on the ARL's Facebook page or post it on your own. If you work there, you're supposedly an animal lover. Be more compassionate. Take an extra step. Everyone carries their phone in their back pocket. Everyone has a smartphone. And for the people that don't have smartphones or social media, this is where that hold would come in. And not everyone has the ability to spend hours during the day. They have families. They have jobs. They travel. You know, they don't have internet access. So you have to think of everyone in the community, not just the younger people, but the elderly and the seniors that have animals that this could happen to.
Yes.
And thing is, social media was utilized, and that's how they found out that Sir Diddy was there. But unfortunately, it didn't work in the long run. And I would suggest that the Animal Rescue League post more photographs on their Facebook page to show. And if they have an Instagram account, do that there too. We're coming down to the last minute or so. I just want to give some final thoughts to the Animal Rescue League. This is not about bashing the Animal Rescue League. We want to help the Animal Rescue League succeed in this community because it is needed. Without it, these animals will be the losers. So you need to be transparent. Share the policies that you plan to have. Have some training to understand the behavior of animals that come into the shelter, that behavior just may not be indicative of who they really are. Have training as far as microchipping, to scan the microchip. You need that. Sir Diddy should not have died. And learn to decipher aggressive behavior versus just being stressed out, being in a new environment, because there is a difference. Because this has happened too much now where cats have been deemed aggressive. And I have more cases, but I don't have time to discuss it. And allow people time to find their pets. The 24 hours when you're closed does nothing for anybody to find their pet. And lastly, I want to say to the people out there who are bashing them and want them to close down, become no-kill. First, no-kill is so much harder than you can imagine. I'm not saying it's impossible. But to threaten to firebomb the homes of the staff, that is unacceptable as well. You cannot threaten violence. What does that do? I know you're upset, but let's be part of the solution. This is a community problem, and so the community has to come together. The ARL needs to be open and listen to what the public is saying. They need to enact better guidelines, better protocols, and better policies, and they need to be transparent about it. We cannot allow this to happen again. And so I say to Cody and Samantha, we all say we are so sorry for your loss. And just one more note, the deer on the roads are out right now. And people are hitting them left and right. If you notice, there's so many dead deer. They are moving right now because the bucks are running after the does to impregnate them. So the does are running on the road and the bucks are following them. So, and it's happening between dusk and dawn. So that's when visibility is very low. Really be careful because deer can do some serious damage to your cars. And we all wish you a very happy Thanksgiving. Until next time, bye.